Membros of the Ejecutivo.
Members of the Diplomatic Corps. Members of staff and special advisors. This afternoon is my task to introduce the chairperson of this afternoon's proceedings. This person comes with a wealth of knowledge and experience in the literary arts. He started off as an avid reader in the juvenile department of the National Library. And he's now the chairman of the National Guidance Committee. He has numerous publications to his name. The Baldwin Saga, An Introduction to Guyanese Literature, just to name a few. He is the host of two television programs, Oral Tradition and Between the Lines on NCN. He's the writer of two columns in our Sunday Chronicle and Sunday Guyana Times, entitled Preserving Our Literary Heritage and Shaping of Guyanese Literature. He's also the editor of the Guyana Annual, formerly the Chronicle Christmas. He's an international representative of arts in many countries, including Trinidad and Tobago, Suriname, Cuba, just to mention a few. He's the coordinator of numerous literary events at home, including World Poetry Day, World Storytelling Day, World Book and Copyright Day, just to mention a few. His contributions to the literary world has been recognized by many organizations, one being the Guyana Cultural Association of New Year Guyana Folk Festival Award. He's the coordinator of WIC, Writers in Concert. He's married and has two children in the medical field. His work is ongoing, and we could not have chosen a better person to fit into the slot of chairperson for this afternoon's proceedings. I will now call to the podium no one else but a born, bred Guyanese writer, editor, and publisher who is igniting the landscape of Guyanese literature. I now call to the podium Mr. Tambo himself. He's at the podium.
Thank you, Ms. James. And good afternoon to everyone.
Could I start again? Are you hearing me?
Yes.
Something is wrong with the mic. Controversial war. What's the reality? We live in a world of paradoxes, but through books and through dialogue, we are able to grapple with certain situations, like safeguarding every aspect of the book, the writer's publishers, translators, illustrators, and the readers. All these aspects are important, and important also is an instrument to protect and sustain all aspects of creativity. In keeping with our theme, history and story, here are two stories. There was a time during the paperback revolution when people used to line up to buy books. Right here in Guyana, right around the corner at Fogarty's, Booker's Universal Store, which is now Guyana's store. At that time of the paperback revolution, bookstores were hastily set up across the country to supply the demand for books. Many, many years ago, story like fashion, in a province in Spain, there was a time on St. George's Day, April 23, when a rose was given for each book sold. If we were to superimpose those two stories, then we would have a rose garden near the bookstores, and what a pretty sight that would have been. Talking about stories, the theme for 2014 World Book of Copyright Day is history and stories. History is our story told in whatever format we use today. But this evening, we will be treated to stories or perceptive on local and international copyright issues. So it's my duty to guide you through our story of copyright, moving from point A to point B and see what happens. Today, Wednesday, is World Book and Copyright Day. Friday, April 26th, is designated World Intellectual Property Day. The objectives of both events are almost identical. The main aim for World Intellectual Property Day is to raise awareness on how patents, trademarks, and copyright affect daily life and how it helps promote creativity and innovation. The main aim of World Book and Copyright Day is to focus on books to promote reading, to encourage publishing and protection of intellectual property through copyright. For me, copyright is to encourage creativity, better crafted words, and hence more elucidation, learning, entertainment. For me, copyright breeds innovation. In 1995, World Book and Copyright Day was established by the United Nations Educational, Scientific, and Cultural Organization, UNESCO, a move that would serve as a worldwide celebration of books, to promote reading, to encourage publishing, and to protect the protection of intellectual property through copyright. April 23rd was adopted according to UNESCO because it was on that day in 1660 that persons, writers like Cervantes, Shakespeare, and others died. April 23 is also associated with the birth or death of other well-known writers like Vladimir Nabokov, Joseph Flack, Kiljan Laxness, and others. Miss Irina Okova, the UN Director General, in her message for this event said, and I quote, "The history of the written word is the history of humanity. Books are not immune from a world of change. Change is raising sharp questions about the definition of the book and the meaning of authorship in the digital era." End of quote. I've been involved in numerous events to mark World Book and Copyright Day. But this is the first time I kept typing World Book and Copyright Say. World Book and Copyright Say. A little slip, but after a while I started doing it as if by design. So we can dub this event as World Book and Copyright Say. Now, let me make way for others to have their say and invite the chief librarian, Miss Emily King, who was thrust into this position because of the, some say, untimely death of Gillian Thompson, our former chief librarian. So it was, there was no transition period for Miss King. There was no honeymoon period for Miss King. And she took the reign of heading the National Library with gusto. And she's doing fine job. So let's now welcome Miss Emily King.
The intention of this presentation is to give you an idea of what intellectual property Tom Hodge, Yes Nyepol, Samuel Selman, and a number of others. I believe very firmly, however, that on this day we need to honor the numerous Guyanese authors who have documented our history, molded and promoted our culture, fed our curiosity, shaped our national consciousness, our sense of belonging, and fired our loyalties. I think of the well-known and celebrated authors, Martin Carter, A.J. Seymour, Edgar Allan Poe, Wilson Harris, Jan Brewer, A.L. Luca, who was the composer of the lyrics of the National Anthem, Walter Mann A. Lawrence, who wrote the words to the national song, "O Beautiful Guyana." The music was, of course, composed by the great Valerie Rodway, Ian MacDonald, and others. And then we come to the lesser-known authors, such as Mercedes Pierre Dubois, J.W. Chinnaman, Mahalai Das, Shani Yarden, Helen Tate, Henry Josiah, R. Ivan Forrester, Laurie Prince, Donald Fontaine, Jacqueline Weaver, and Drew Warren, and on. I think it is only fitting that we create National Day of Observance and perhaps establish a monument to honor and promote the works of these hundreds of Guyanese people, authors and creators who remain unsung and unknown, because it is important that we honor our literary heritage. The intention of the United Nations of creating World Book and Copyright Day is to pay tribute to all writers and their contribution to world culture, the books they wrote, and the copyright which protects these works. This honor is now extended to all creators who deal with copyright protection. On this day as well, in select years, the United Nations awards the UNESCO Prize for Children and Young People's Literature in service of tolerance. It is, as you have heard, the aspiration of the UN that the celebration will increase the awareness of and adherence to copyright laws, as well as the understanding of intellectual property in general. In my opinion, that is a far-fetched aspiration because of what obtains in the world of international intellectual property law and policy, and I will show you exactly what I mean. In recent decades, intellectual property has become an imposing element of the world economy because of the exponential growth of the internet and internet-based economic activities, which touches every aspect of life, from international trade to internet dating. Whatever works. The concept of intellectual property is premised on creations of the mind, or so-called intangibles, which are literary and artistic works, symbols and designs, names and images used in commerce, among other things. Intellectual property is generally protected by law in the forms of patents, trademarks, and copyright, which are part of the domestic law in most countries. Most countries have laws that pertain to intellectual property. We will later look at whether or not they are extant, relevant, or whether they are enforced. But there are also a number of international regimens attached to the World Trade Organization, such as the trade-related aspects of intellectual property rights known as TRIPS. And I will have to apologize because the PowerPoint could not work with the actual currently sits on the table behind you. However, there is a list of these international regimens that are relevant to the world today, which is one of them. Now, international intellectual property law is a patchwork of intersecting multilateral and bilateral agreements and their resulting harmonization of national law. So you have a number of multilateral agreements among countries, bilateral agreements between countries, through which the and other traditions have value, which have been tapped into by international companies who take the important parts of lessons and other traditions, market them, make a lot of money, and no credit, no returns are made to the countries or the indigenous peoples from which they got that information. So traditional knowledge has now become a very important part of intellectual property in the Caribbean, in whatever state it is at this time. Now, in addition to that, you have some new forms of protection. And these are cutting-edge intellectual property issues, which are dealt with at the level of the World Intellectual Property Organization, which I might add is a very exciting place to be, because of everything that is happening in the intersection of law and technology. But along with these forms of protection, we have had trade globalization. And that has had a direct effect on the harmonization of national laws through the World Trade Organization and the famous TRIPS agreements, as well as other regional organizations such as the African Regional Intellectual Property Organization. The lesser known areas of this form of the law include rights of publicity, moral rights, which I found rather surprising. How can you possibly want to protect moral rights? But evidently, that is one of the lesser known and newer developing areas of intellectual property law and requires some more investigation. There is also misappropriation, which is similar to passing off the law of tort. As when I give you a lecture on passing off the law of tort, because it's similar. You take somebody's thing and you misappropriate it and pass it off into the same. It's a similar concept, but we'll pass that for now. There is also unfair competition, which comes from the law of international trade and has somehow managed to nudge its way into the international intellectual property law. This is because there is so much intersection in the different areas of the law, whether we like it or not. You also have geographical indications of origin, which is not so much unknown, because we have a situation where you have Demerara sugar, which is not from Guyana, being marketed in other parts of the world, and the copyright being claimed for that particular name. They want to trademark, they want protection in intellectual property for it, but it's not theirs. So, geographical indications is a huge thing. For example, champagne must come from Champagne, France. That's enough for that. But we don't have the same privilege because we don't know how to get out there on the world stage and claim what belongs to us. As long as we remain in a state where we have piecemeal legislation and where there is absolutely no consensus of how we approach national intellectual property law and policy, this is going to be the result for some time. In addition to these new forms of protection that are being sought, you have trade dress, licensing, plant variety protection, and you can understand why that is so. Integrated circuit protection, which has to do with computers and internet, and para copyright, which is also known as meta copyright and sometimes pseudo copyright. And I found that to be quite interesting. The para copyright you will come across a little more often, because it is a term that refers to an umbrella of legal protections above and beyond traditional copyright. Even if you're not paying attention now, you're going to find that it creeps in more and more as we get on with the advancement of the internet along the way. But the description of para copyright is that it refers to legal protections above and beyond traditional copyright, and that it is often cited as legal protection for technical measures. And this originated from the 1996 WIPO, that is the World Intellectual Property Organization, Internet Treaty. Provisions for para copyright Now, there are some very interesting elements to all of this, and I will proceed to show you exactly how it applies to you, to all of us, how it is extant. For example, a technical measure cannot stop a technically sophisticated person who wishes to infringe copyright. I think we know that they say the stricter the government, the wiser the population. If you know what you're doing, you can get around just about any law or potentially anyone who is out there. So to use a digital locks analogy, there is no need to pick the lock, as the keys necessary to decode the content are already embedded within the authorized access technology. So whatever it has been created already has within it the means to get into it. So if you're smart, you'll text out, you know how to do it. Now both the locked content and the technology containing the keys are also commercially available to be printed. So there's everything up there for you to undo what has already been done. As long as one person holds that technical measure, the content will be made available to everyone else, and the whole thing goes in the board. So the effects of these measures will have power copyright are to enforce specific contractual licenses, licensing agreements, on those conforming to copyright law. The concept, therefore, is part of contract law when you have an agreement between persons and not necessarily as falling under the umbrella of copyright law as a form of protection. I know that's a lot to get accustomed to, but you will come to understand this very better. Now, it's unfortunate, but the most important regulations regarding consumer protection, among which are the freedom to contract. You can contract with anyone you want to for whatever purposes, except of course if they're illegal, are not a part of this idea of power copyright laws. So even though you've got particular licensing that can be done, you're not necessarily free to contract as you do. So it is very limited, and that is perhaps why it is known as pseudo copyright law. Because the whole thing creates a lot of imbalances, and there are harmful consequences that come from it. Now, it is an interesting fact of physical property that sometimes have elements of intellectual property, as in the case where you've got a piece of machinery which has a part of it that is patented. So you have a physical piece of property, whatever it is, and within that you have something that is based on something that is copyrighted. Same thing happens with a book, where you may have parts of it that have been previously copyrighted, or a website that has photographs that are copyrighted. Intellectual property laws, you must remember, often define what a person can or cannot do with the intangible, which is the ideas, or with a copy of the tangible, which may contain the intangible. I think that we are living in exciting times on the cutting edge of law and technology. It's really something to see and experience. public policy and the public interest. Public interest helps to create public policy, and in systems where proper governing is done, public policy is used to create the basis of laws. All of these issues come together when we talk about the enforcement of laws, and particularly the enforcement of intellectual property laws. Traditional methods of publishing, for example, comprise multinational conglomerates with many layers of management, in regulations and signed off. So that was the intention of the Berne Agreement. The Berne Convention, which was established in the 1800s, because it has been unsuccessful, however, in reducing the differences in substantive issues, which is, as I mentioned before, who resolves which dispute in what country, if a judgment is given, where will it be enforced and how, and who will police the whole thing. And there are issues, of course, which arise when countries sign on and don't sign up. Meaning, of course, you can sign what you like. But you need to put measures in place to have the laws implemented in your own country. And that doesn't happen. We have lots of signatures, nothing to do. We come to that in a short while. The reason is that the Berne Convention is not self-executing, which means that countries who are signatories, as I just said, must still enact legislation to give local effect to the provisions of the convention. There are still, therefore, many regulations within the jurisdictions regarding things like fair use. What is fair use? What is fair use of a book? Can I photocopy the entire thing, distribute it as much as I like, or photocopy the entire thing and resell it to others as a profit? Is that fair use? It is not under intellectual property law generally understood. That is a breach of copyright provisions. You shouldn't do that. In many countries, you cannot do that. Fair use would be, for academic purposes, the ability to photocopy a certain percentage of that book and to use it responsibly. That is fair use. So, within different countries, we have variations regarding these issues. The duration of protection. Will protection be 30 years? Will it be 50? Will it be 70? Will it be 10 or 20? Each country has different ideas about how long authors' rights need to be protected. And of course, the question of authorship and ownership regarding works that are for hire. So if you're in thought of faith, authorship, ownership, and so on. The list of issues goes on. Now, the speed at which data travels, the need for swift action, the need to establish a uniform choice of law provisions, which I described, within the Berne Convention family of treaties, the WIPO treaties, the TRIPS arrangement, which is the which comes out of the World Trade Organization's agreements, and a number of others, becomes problematic. The Berne Convention, for example, was drafted and ratified by over 150 nations in 1886. This was to make sure that everything was protected across the globe. And it also sought, and this is important to remember, to establish equal treatment in each of the signatory nations' jurisdictions by establishing a minimum standard. So if you signed on to the Berne Convention, there needed to be minimum standards in every country should have the same treatment across jurisdictions. If I'm an author and I write here, I should be treated the same way in your country as you would be in mine. That was the idea. It has not happened. The United States, very interestingly, acceded to the Berne Convention in 1988, more than just about 100 years after it was established. So again, you begin to see that even internationally, while they beat others on the head, they too have been reluctant with issues of copyright and intellectual property on an international scale. Take care of things at home, but there is a problem necessary with reciprocity across borders. So it is not quite as simple as it has been portrayed in the past, where people just sing a happy song and they're doing it all about copyright, and one people would be giving all their offers, all the recognition that you should give our student. It hasn't happened yet. There is still work in progress. And in fact, what they did was to respond to the Berne Convention by setting up two conventions of their own. We'll talk about that shortly. The WIPO Copyright Treaty is another one that was drafted just in 1996 in order to help copyright law keep pace with changing times. The United States responded to that. adopted the requirements of the Berne Convention by creating a directive on copyright in e-commerce. And that required member states within the European Union to harmonize their laws concerning rights of reproduction, communication to the public, distribution rights, and technological measures against circumvention of copyright management protection systems. There are several articles, and I will just mention one or two. Article 1 outlines the intended scope, through such sort of a comprehensive definition, that is, what is reproduction right, and covers all the relevant acts of reproduction, what constitutes reproduction, and so on, whether it's online, whether it's offline, whether it's in hard form, or whether it's material. Now, on February 14, 2001, the European Parliament formally adopted the European Copyright Directive, and the intention of this Copyright Directive was to solidify the existence of the EU-wide internal market on copyright and related rights. So it seems as though, of all the areas of the world, the European Union has the most stable approach to copyright and to related rights, because it has harmonized and been required, and they've had to do it. They've had to harmonize the copyright laws within the countries that are members of the European Union. And they have established a legislative framework which should be able, they project that they will handle the impending challenges of this great digital revolution of which we are part. Now I come to my favorite place in the world. What is happening with us in the country? You have an idea of what happens internationally, how advanced we are, and what issues are for them. What is happening here? In our part of the world, the establishment of copyright policies and laws has received attention because of the current trends that I described, some of which I described in international IP law policy. There has been an insistence on greater accountability and compliance with IP regimen, especially when it comes to the internet economy and everything that is circles modern IP, the internet economy. For the purpose of our discourse, Caribbean countries will be limited to the members of the Caribbean community of CARICOM and further required to exclude certain applications, simply because they have civil law systems in jurisdiction, which we don't quite understand as yet. However, I am told that KT doesn't have that much to advance in terms of intellectual property as a whole. Nevertheless, we have to be careful of how we describe the legal systems in other countries. If we don't understand what happens in the civil law system, we need to leave it to you. Now, the increased pressures experienced by the region to comply with international agreements such as the TRIPS agreement is simply because it is a requirement of the World Trade Organization. As developing countries, if you want to benefit from trade arrangements through the World Trade Organization, you have to sign on to TRIPS. There is no other way. TRIPS means trade-related aspects of intellectual property rights. Trade-related aspects of intellectual property rights, if you wish to do trade, there are some minimum standards that you have to follow as far as intellectual property is concerned, or as you do not trade with the World Trade Organization. At least that's how it's supposed to work. So the most CARICOM countries, which are members of the WTO, are required to enact legislation to give effect to this TRIPS. A few countries have attempted to enact this legislation in order to reflect the requirements of the TRIPS agreement. Jamaica, St. Lucia have modeled more successful laws, while Trinidad and Tobago has enacted some strong copyright laws. Most other countries have had partial or no enactment compliance with TRIPS at all, even though most have signed on to the agreement. So as I said before, you can sign whatever you like. It's not a matter of actually involved in making it happen. Now, there has been a considerable amount of reluctance, or perhaps inability, of most of these countries. there are different focus points, and there are different levels of modernity as well as flexibility. Enforcement, who is the twin sister of the law, possesses the same characteristics, in the sense that some people, some countries, well, of course, the law is more stringently than others, and in some cases it's not enforced at all. Guyana, for example, has one of the oldest copyright laws dating back to 1956, because it was acquired through reception from the British legal system after Guyana became independent in 1966. You might be interested to know that England is not allowed to rid of that piece of legislation in New York. Remember the amount of what they got to behind. And this is in spite of the TRIPS arranged, the TRIPS membership, and the agreement. There have been no legal legislation, no supporting mechanisms or organizations, and no awareness programs, and the law is generally ignored. I feel as a Guyanese I am free to tell you the truth. That is indeed the situation here. Jamaica, on the other hand, has put stringent copyright laws in place, and perhaps too stringent, because it does not deal effectively with policy issues, and then move to the legal issues, but goes the other way around. To divert very slightly, if you are going to create laws that are going to be effective in any society, you have to see what is happening on the ground, create the necessary policies, and then create the regulations so that it will affect what is happening below. That is supposed to be the logical way of doing things. Unfortunately, when countries feel pressured by international regimen, TRIPS, WTO, and so on, they put the laws in place first and then say everyone else has to follow. It doesn't work. In Kenya, it hasn't worked. So what happens is a continuous revisiting of the laws so that they can make sense and actually be complied with at some level by the people who are affected. What is the point of beating people off the streets with these copyrighted goods when there is no other means for them to make a living? Let's simply go back to Guyana. You have to address what is happening at that level in numerous policies and laws that will balance the interests of all the parties. So always dealing with these issues as a policy analysis, the advice countries to balance the interests between the parties on the ground, the government, the economic situation, as well as the international regime. In other words, they have to wait. You need to get your house in order quickly. But say to them, these are some of the things that we will not be able to do because we're not going to make life unduly difficult for our people. This is what CARICOM, countries and citizens, have been unable to do. They have the wherewithal and probably the skill understand that this is the direction we can take in creating policy and creating law, especially with regard to international intellectual property law and policy. Now, again to the list, St. Lucia has legislation which is progressive, seemingly progressive. When you look at the other legislation, it has things that tend to be more protective of copyright and other areas of intellectual property. It sounds good, of literature, they're talking about it. They're not necessarily the kind of people who want to be around for too long because they begin to become lazy and unproductive, or they belong to a different species and genre of people. We have to look at it as being a very important aspect of our culture, something that adds significantly to who we are. I work all the time, like as our practice. But now to the CSMB, which is so heavily touted, in which Caribbean people hold so much out and which has so much yet to be done before we can begin to see any benefit. This arrangement, the CSMB, the Caribbean Single Market and Economy, was established on the 1st of January 2006. It was formally established and adopted by 12 member countries, and I will give you the names: Belize, Barbados, Grenada, St. Kitts and Nevis, St. Lucia and St. Vincent, the Grenadines, Jamaica, Suriname, Antigua, Barbuda, Guyana, and Dominica, Trinidad and Tobago. The schedule of implementation required a formal framework to be in place by 2008, the final completion date set for 2015, which is next year. I think that's interesting. CSMA was originally proposed by Carrie Club in 1989 in the 1989 Declaration of Grand Dance, and was conceptually and legally formalized in the 2001 Revised Treaty of Shadow Lands. Revised Treaty included provisions for the establishment of the Caribbean Court of Justice, which was formalized in 2005. So this CSMA was established with the intention of creating a cohesive framework to which the region could become internationally competitive. The main objectives of the CSLB are set out as follows, and I could not resist the quote of you. Full use of labor, that is full employment, and full exploitation of the other factors of production, natural resources and capital being those. Competitive production leading to greater variety and quantity of products and services to trade with other countries. It is expected that these objectives will in turn provide improved standards of living, work, and sustained economic development, among other things. I argue, and I believe that you will agree with me, that in order for these objectives to be 11 Latin American and Caribbean countries, which is titled, has the implementation of the TRIPS agreement in Latin America and the Caribbean produced intellectual property legislation in favors public health? It deals with one aspect, which is public health. And it says that these countries are not adequately taking advantage of the TRIPS flexibility. Within the TRIPS agreement, there are flexibilities which are supposed to allow countries to develop certain areas of intellectual property in different ways. So you're not supposed to be forced to adapt everything at the same time and at the same level as everyone else. And these studies have found that it hasn't been done effectively, or perhaps they have not taken advantage of these so-called flexibilities at all. And it dealt, of course, with the term of the patent system, how long it would be, what is patentable subject matter, whether you can just pick this up and say, I'm going to patent this or I'm going to patent that. What is patentable subject matter? Not everything is suitable as patent subject matter. Who deals with the reversal of the burden of proof of patent infringement? Who infringes patent and who is responsible for proving that patent has been infringed? Exhaustion of rights, when the rights come to an end. Compulsory licensing, and of course, early working exceptions, which will allow the country to complete all necessary procedures to register a product before the patent expires. These are just some technical details. But the study concluded in Access to Medicine might be rolling in the future with new agreements to establish more restrictive rules for IPRs not put in place. In other words, if we don't comply, some of these TRIPS arrangements or access to medicine to this part of the world will become restricted. So we buy the dog and get worse. And that is an idea of how the international community operates. How do we deal with this? CARICOM countries, they say, need to improve interaction between health and patent offices. Maybe one patent office in the country. I might be able to give you an idea of two or three of them. A few months ago, I met with the heads of registrars or copyright offices in the Caribbean. And they're not even properly run. A patent office looks like somebody's registry at the Supreme Court, which has a set of boxes in which people can file whatever those patents or pieces of paper are thrown. And well, if you're lucky, you might find it some other time. And the patents officer is somebody working in the registry. And that is how it has gone on across the Caribbean for a very long period of time. We do not have proper documentation of these things. Almost far. I know Trinidad has done a better job in the house, in Jamaica. But even in Jamaica, there is one lady who is responsible for the office, and she has one assistant. So that gives you an idea of the condition in which we are at this time in the region with regards to things like registering your patents, your trademarks, and your copyrights. Of course, registration of copyrights takes different forms in different countries. The usual thing we say is if you have something that you want to copyright, you put it in an envelope, post it to yourself, and don't open it and then you go to court, then you take it before the judge and show that that is what you have. That is as far as we have gone in terms of being able to prove that you have some kind of copyright entanglement. That is as far as we've gone. Get a name, Jason. Entertaining and amusing, comical, but it is a serious matter. 10 years ago, we were not in the position that we are in today, as far as the internet and things that have developed are concerned. Every 6 months or so, a new smartphone or some device comes out, and you find that what you bought 6 months ago is almost obsolete. You find that another 3 months, somebody is selling you something else, and then there are other iterations, and then somebody creates an app that goes with it, and suddenly that. than the copyright law saying you can do. The publishers from England reacted by filing a court action at the same time engaging the diplomacy to the British government. So you have all of this going on, and people were scurrying on the talks to have the issue resolved. Now Guyana is a signatory to the World Trade Organization and to the 15th. Of course, as we mentioned before, nothing has been enacted over, so that has been done. Even with the Berne Convention, nothing has also been done. So there is no way that anything can come out of the 14th. There must be something to go on. You can't go and say, Your Honor, fix this. Her Honor, or His Honor, must be able to refer to the law in order to give some sort of judgment, so that these things can be resolved. So it's nothing. Eventually, it was economic diplomacy that this country started with perhaps a little bit of stress or pressure that resolved the issues. I think that as citizens, we need to say to policymakers that we really need to get some things in place so that we can be more humble. As a country, where will we be if all that we have is a begging bowl to go around telling people, I'm not ready yet. You can't talk to me, we're not ready as yet. We need extra time. And over the years, we have been signing lots of conventions without signing up. You are aware of the developments. The world is moving forward. Internationally, things are happening at a fast rate. There is intersection between so many different among so many different areas of the law, international consumer law, private international law, international trade, contract laws, and all of this provides to make international intellectual property law what it is. It's exciting. It is scintillating. It is far more exciting, I think, to me than anything that can happen in domestic law. But we have to look at our policies as countries, seeing what can be done to fix some of these problems. What can we do as ordinary citizens in order to perhaps propel the policy makers in the direction that is informed, that helps them to use advanced tools to come up with some ideas, come up with policies and laws that will do two things, or do some of the things that I mentioned before. And most importantly, balance the interests between the country's responsibilities and the needs of the citizens who live in. These are some of the things that are necessary in copyright, as well as in all aspects of intellectual property. Writers have to eat. I will leave you with a quotation from a famous publisher. His name is Jason Epstein, and speaking at a Whitehall event of this nature, he said, "Our civilization has been enriched, preserved, interpreted, and handed down to us mainly by writers. Our future too is in their hands. Copyright is the sine qua non of their survival. Without it, writers cannot afford to write, and none of them shall be wearing in the dark." These are things that we need to consider when we think of intellectual property and copyright. Where are we? Are we learning? What can we do about it?
Got to live. But also the violence, hesitation, you left us more questions than answers.
Yeah, very much so.
More questions than answers. So where do we go from here? Where do we go from here? There's so much in what you have said. There's so much in what you have said. Is that more questions than answers? Where do we go? Where do we start? How do we strike balance between all of them? Not having to force people, being able to make your own argument for it, being able to live. I envy because I write, currently. Not much of a living in death. I write for a living. I like pick because I don't see writing as work. See a cup into building the door. They see a bridge being built, but they don't see the work of a writer as work. They don't see the work. But they see the performance of that. But behind the performer, there's some writing. Behind the stage play, there's writing. What do we do? I mean, there's so many things that you've raised there. I cannot, and I will not leave on the table. I don't have to say wow. Just a moment. But one thing, how can we relate the importance of copyright to how can we, the ordinary people, write it down? How can we let government know how important it is? Copyright is to the development to the country. There seems to be a missing word here. How important it is to be government? And the balance is how can we also produce and create the idea from it. Balance again. I have here to remind us that one of the years down. I mean, this is our little saying here is out. But we have work. We have work. It will take time to put system in place. I'm happy, you know, you mentioned China, Japan, Singapore, how they have been robust in fighting their mentioned. Personal experience working in Supreme Court years and years ago, they were many being lodged in Supreme Court, tons and tons of it. If you go there now, it's crazy. It is crazy. What happened to all creators? Are we not valuing our work that happened? And I'm talking years and years, 7 days I've been working on the Supreme Court. And I've seen these, you know, great ideas. Every year we continue education on the science scale. And some great things come up with that. But have we taken the time to register these creations? Have we taken the time? Guyana is a signatory to a number of organizations like the 1906 Copyright Act, the Universal Copyright Convention, the World Convention 1907, quite old, and things like that. Now, just for a few minutes, I will allow you to have your say. Just for a few minutes. Yes, sir.
My question is,
please, your name and...
Money out.
Money out and...
I'm right to... I came in this afternoon very excited. I really wanted to hear the presentation. I'm impressed with you. But at the ending of the day, I'm asking myself how much you have said in the story of them. It sounds like it's a situation of doom for us when our heads of nations cannot come together for something comprehensive. When our country does not really enact laws, there are no laws for the judicial system to work on, and that leaves us very fear. If one thing you said that was a glimmer of hope, when you said that the person that now, because of the moving trend for the internet, that one can open a blog and become a publisher and a writer. How can that help preserve or protect work that I might put out there on the internet? I'm just asking that question as against the fact that if that work is challenged, how will the internet help establish who's the rightful owner of it? I mean, I'm just asking it because it seems like there's no other way to put it. And I'm saying that because I thought at one time that writing a letter or a song on a piece of paper, put it in an envelope or post it back to you was effective. But I've learned from a few international lives that it won't really work in our country. It's useless. So is there anything, I know you say that this is going to take time, but in taking time, work can be stolen, we can be left naked. Is there anything that we can do now, given where technology is, that can protect us?
All right, we'll take the questions in bunches. Okay. Just that.
Tomorrow it will be different. You need to move with it, adjust, and adapt. copying your books, you don't like it, do as has been done in other countries, make an arrangement with her, since you like the copy so much. There is a system where you can have digital licensing that you immediately have the arrangement from the publisher, so that the person who's photocopying probably still gets something, and the publisher gets something. So people have been innovative and moving forward, that's what they have to do. No point holding on to what's gone behind. So these are some of the things we can do. Chinese government seems to like photocopying. And so what they needed to do was to make an arrangement with the publishers of the seats so that the publishers would get something. And books would be immediately available by print on demand. Print on demand means that the books come as required. Print on demand is a good thing too. So you can also do that. Marketing of your work is also important. When you've got the internet to market your work, don't sit here and depend on things happening in your internet. You can market it elsewhere. You can get a profit of some sort. The laws require a lot of work. Everything has to tie into international measurement. It's a huge people. It's not just a few people requiring it from the net. You have to move with the time, you have to move forward. So there's no need for despair. What there is need for is action and we have right now.
Yes.
Here in Guyana, as an orator of the country, we had a forever And it will seem to me as if we have to make some kind of, if you like, transition to get to that stage where you can say, yes, you're doing sufficient, and you're adhering to what we describe as best practices visibly implemented. However, law is law. If you don't adhere and comply to the law, it means that you contravene the law. That's the interpretation. But however, see that laws are made by either corporations, institutions, or groups of men over it. These laws can also be transformed, and I think that is the point Mr. Jones is making when he referred to Mr. Jadil and his position. But I would have us understand that there are other processes. For example, right now in the Islamic countries, books of Islam are being printed in a phenomenal rate. I'm not saying it's going to continue indefinitely, but I just would like us to accept that there are exceptions, there are alternatives to a decline. You mentioned Barnes & Noble, there are others. Well established book publishers that are going to decline because of the internet, because of the Arab Spring has generated those forces that has led to an intensification in book publication. But in those countries, it is not important. That's one thing. Other thing I think we should look at from the Guyana perspective is satellites. Right now, Guyana is very geographically near to Kourou, which is the French satellite base. I want to believe that even the trend towards, if you like, or as a result of brain drain, you know, it would be possible to reverse the situation favorable to the Guyana situation, or even the CARICOM situation. The Bahamas gives you an example. Therefore, it would seem to me that best practices will have to be linked with technology. And that technology could only become a reality if these countries come together. They have to collaborate. There is no one single small country that can do it on their own. That's out of the question. So it would seem to me, one, the law. Two, compliance. Three, best practices. And four, collaboration of the small countries on a regional or hemispheric basis, utilizing technology to adhere, to comply with the demands of intellectual property as protection.
That's a very interesting implementation to enforcement, which we have not done
Thank you.
Yes, I wish to thank you very kindly for your wonderful discourse. What saddens me though is that really people who should hear these discussions don't come. And we don't have the media to disseminate the information. I don't know if this lady is from any of the people, but yes. The library. Where is she from? Where was she from? Any more? When we have things like these, I think we should invite a wide cross-section of
people.
It's more or less a waste of time. You're speaking to the affected more or less, and in some cases you say it's important to people, more than before. And you mentioned that many of these things you have to take the local situation into consideration and all that. But I remember when in our country this ugly court of copyright infringement rate is set to 2001. The prime provider of these things said he didn't know it was wrong. He rang me on Saturday, the man of the and, the fellow said he was going to be wrong, he said he was going to be wrong. But he didn't know it was wrong. He said, well, you know, it's wrong, he's only got a piece called copyright and said no party to be represented, no commission and so on. But he never stopped. And this man is a man of what we call a man of the cloth. He wore those, that pumpkin colored jacket with a little stuff here and the back and all of that. Creative man. He didn't know it was wrong. His brothers in the field told him it was wrong and stuff. But he was making so much money that he couldn't stop. Now he has progressed in his favor, he's doing things in color. And he's really good at what he's doing, you know, passing off. He got the thing resembles the original, quite nicely. And you mentioned he has to be political good, I don't think. You know, like, can you see that happen? I've attempted several times to just put a paradox in those doors. We have no bookshop in Guyana. Let's see how it looks. The outside door and the people in. What? I mean, temptation has crossed my mind several times.
Please lie. Close
this in and rent it out as another bookshop or something. Now let's have fun. Or a Chinese restaurant or whatever. I would still live. But there is no seriousness on the part of this administration to do anything. I mean, you said correctly the law that we govern by now is 56 laws. Where the penalty is $60,000. And that means happening. And I would ask permission from people now because we've got a lot of feedback. But unless, I don't know, the world wants to and other things, hobbling and screaming and so on, I think if they've got a boycott, like I do not participate in any national event where I ask the company. If they can't, you've got to do something for it. No, I can't do that. You're not doing anything to ensure the survival of the entity. Why should I participate to make the country look good and you got to score if you got one? I can't be in that. I do what any several times. Don't ask me. People write and ask. No, I can't be in that. I've lived too long to be treated any more.
Before you do go, I'd like to say a few words. There's a question of service to the fellow members. Please don't go.
Yeah, well, this is one of the considerations, you know what I mean? One of the joys of people of the store going is to see the happy faces of parents, children, and find something that they really like. I am so thrilled when I see people there sitting down on the floor and, you know, crawling and reading a book. I feel happy about that. I feel I'm doing something worth it. But it is so sad for young producers in Guyana who can't own a living. I mean, you know, a singer in any other proper country can establish himself and live comfortably off his talent. He's going to chop everybody down with a song and a cat on the door or in a coffee shop, and you can't get anything. No encouragement for creativity.
All right.
Maybe.
Thank you. Thank you.
Yeah, I just want to make a quick report.
Quick, thank you.
Yeah, quick. I'll be very quick. It's just to inform that we have an association that was formed about a few months ago called the Guyana Music Network, in which we have all 400 members, and we're formed this organization or this one with the intention of lobbying the computer for the association.
I think that's a good start when you're in the room.
What's it done so far?
Good.
I mean, what's it done so far in the room? Probably more than suggested the process of gathering number before we can make
them. Well, if you can do that afterwards, we have a couple of things to do.
Okay.
Before I call this lady more, to give a word of appreciation, I think Ms. Innes planned to make a presentation of books to the National Library.
Some of my own work because I do publish as well. I'm fortunate to have every publisher in Germany so that my copyright in that part of the world is secure. Nevertheless, I have here the first one, which is a legal book, Copying Copyright in the Internet, the issue of internet regulation with regard to copying of copyright. And then I leave a copy with the National Library so that anyone who's interested in the subject can be able to follow it. Interestingly, this was a spin-off from my master's thesis in intellectual property of that word I wanted to publish it. So I rewrote it accordingly and it was published. The second one is Essays in Caribbean Law and Policy, a collection of a number of articles that I've written over the years on policy and legal issues, which makes easier reading than the first, which is more of a textbook song. It has more of a textbook song, and it's more entertaining. So I present that to the National Library as well. And the final one comes from my body, which was, and still is, public speaking. And it comprises of a number of articles that I wrote over a very long period of time that have become useful. And I was asked to put them into solid format. And so this is public speaking skills, tips to becoming a competent presenter.
Yeah.